Hey, welcome. My name is Dan Shuart, and this is the FPOV High Beam podcast number 9. We've done 9 so far. With me today is a friend of mine and also a colleague, David Goodspeed. He's president of OEC Fiber. Welcome, David.
Thank you very much.
How are you doing today?
We're on time.
Yeah. Yeah.
For those who don't know,
that's right.
It's an in-person.
Yeah.
David looked at the invite and thought it was going to be online.
Yeah, I know.
So
we're talking about that's a weird thing now.
It is a weird thing.
Being in-person.
It is a weird thing.
What are you, weird?
It's like in-person? They said, I was reading, we were just talking about it because of this.
Uh-huh.
And one of my guys told me, he said that he read an article that Teams is being used 40% more now than it was during the pandemic.
Really?
Wow. I like you a lot. I'm glad to see you. I haven't seen you since our OU days.
I know. I was thinking about that before, about how long we've known each other. And it just shows how fast time
flies. When did
you
start at OU?
2008.
Yeah. So, yeah, because that's right. Because that's whenever I started.
That's right.
And then left to go to Apple.
Yeah.
And then came back.
Yeah, that's right.
And then,
And one reason during that, our tenure together at OU, University of Oklahoma for our out-of-state
people. We play football.
Yeah, that's right.
And,
but one thing that I always appreciate about you, David, was your out-of-the-box thinking, innovation, right? Was always
drove people crazy.
In a good way. But also your ability to bring executive leadership, like the president, along with your ideas and pushing that envelope. And I want to get into that. But before I do, tell us a bit about your role at OEC Fiber and about the company. Now, we know your title.
Yep.
But how do you see your role? And tell me how that plays out with where you're at today.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just kind of tell the story of how we got here.
Uh-huh.
And I think that's a pretty neat story because it all really started back in the 1930s with the electrification of rural America, right? And, and especially Oklahoma. I was just talking to my mom, who's 82. And we were talking about something, and she said, I said, you remember when you got electricity? She goes, I was like second or third grade.
That's crazy.
She goes, I remember when we didn't have to go outside to go to the bathroom. And I'm like, wow. So I'm standing there looking at my mother, who's, 82, 4 feet tall, pistol, and thinking about how her life has just changed so much, right? So we all know the story about electric, cooperatives were founded on the principles of, the for-profits were saying it's too expensive to go, like where my grandparents, lived in Southwest Oklahoma. They said, it was too far to go, 5 miles outside of town. We're just not going to do it. So the co-ops got together, everybody pitched in some money. So it's member owned, right?
Uh-huh.
So we do what is right for the member. It doesn't matter if it's Dan or David. We try to get your lights on as quick as possible if there's an outage or
so. You look at them as members versus customers.
Members, yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So they're members. So it's member owned.
Yeah.
So it's so any kind of capital credits that we get back or anything like that, we distribute that back to our members, which is pretty unique, right? But so we have a totally different approach on delivering electricity. It's about service. It's about support.
Mm-hmm.
It's about reliability. There's so many factors that go into it. So, back in the 30s when electric co-ops were born, and there's about 900 or so in the country right now, and OEC, Oklahoma Electric Cooperative there in Norman, Oklahoma, is the largest one in the state. We have about close to 50,000 members and then about 65,000 meters. So, meter, one member could have two or three because of a shop or something like that.
And that's commercial as well, right?
Yeah. So that's all in there. So
as president, how do you see that? How is your role other than just being president, right?
I mean, yeah.
What, how do you see your responsibility and goal? Because dealing with members is a different situation, though.
Right. It's a big challenge because when OEC Fiber was formed back in 2017, I kept talking about the experience because I've been an electric member of OECs for well over 25 years now. So I was kind of used to it. We've got board members that, districts. I mean, it's very unique kind of setup, which is pretty, it kind of feels traditional, kind of feels real in a world that doesn't feel real anymore, right?
Yeah.
To a certain extent. And so what makes it so unique about what OEC Fiber does versus OEC is that OEC Fiber is in a competitive market that has just exploded, right? When we started in 2017, it was, the market was what the market was. COVID, don't need to, we'll have podcast 27 about that, right, type thing.
Right.
But so it just changed everybody and changed everything. And so it really, trying to balance a competitive and a non-competitive two industries, because for those who don't know, in Oklahoma, back in 2009, they did what they called allocated territory. We used to compete for electric loads. Uh-huh. So you could choose whether you wanted us or another provider or whatever, and we would build to you and all that stuff. And so there's sure. heavy, heavy competition. Uh-huh. Well, the state came in 2009 and said, no more. We're just going to do allocated territory. So what you got is what you got. So whenever you move into a home, fortunately or unfortunately, you just don't have a choice in your electric provider.
Yeah.
So if it's us, or if it's OG&E or PSO, or you know, maybe a city municipality or something like that, you don't have that. Whereas OEC Fiber, it really was born from this idea that we're going to serve our electric members, but at the same time, we are competing against the big boys and the big girls and in the industry.
Yeah.
And so having a competitive business and having a non-competitive electric utility that I'm balancing
trying to juggle.
Yeah. I had an employee say to me the other day, she goes, I don't know how you survived here because it's so crazy. How do you balance it? And like you said, in my role is to, the best analogy I can give, you remember I used to always give analogies, right?
From early days. You're the king of the analogy.
Yeah, I guess so, right? So if we're breaking any copyright rules, I apologize. But, you know, we've all seen, or most of us have seen, We Were Soldiers. Uh-huh. And at the end, towards when Mel Gibson is standing there and everybody's just shooting at all around.
Yeah.
And he, you know, screams out to one of his privates and he said, you know, broken arrow, broken arrow. And sometimes I just feel like the bullets are just flying around and I'm just standing there in the middle just watching it pass by me and try to understand if I pull this lever, what's going to happen and all that. So being in the competitive space with a non-competitive electric utility is very interesting.
Yeah,
very interesting.
Yeah. Far cry from how higher ed operates. Or, well, you're sort of in the crossfire there as well between that.
Yeah.
So tell me about, not knowing much about that industry, tell me about the innovation. Is there innovation happening just from your baseline delivery, from your, like, the fiber optic capability, or is it pretty much a standard set and the innovation comes more on the business side? Or?
Yeah, you know, we've been struggling with that, I think, quite a bit, because a lot of the partners that we use are trying to find that added revenue, that extra value, you know, or something like that. And I was trying to explain it the other day, and I said, you know, having worked for Apple, I realized that, you know, they made the best device, whether it's a MacBook Pro or the iPad, and we saw this at OU, right? Or the phone, but it was up to us to figure out, what are we going to do with this? How do we harness this tool that we've got? And that's really kind of the, where I think the you know, fiber to the X, you know, fiber to the home, business, or whichever, just allows that, right? Because what we are doing now is we're delivering, we've had members, Dan, that had upload and download speeds of, you know, 10.3.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, we're talking, you know, this is, you know, and we just are still connecting those people to 100-100 symmetrical and just giving them the ability to stream Netflix, which is something we've never... You know, so there's a, we're kind of, you know, some people say you don't want to be the dumb pipe.
Yeah.
You know, own your customer, own your whatever, blah, blah, blah. But sometimes I kind of view it as maybe you do want to be the dumb pipe because, you know, Apple, one of the best stories I've got from my tenure there is that I opened up a spreadsheet one day and I'm trying to follow along and I said, you know, well, I can't seem to understand what you guys are talking about. I can't find, I felt kind of dumb, right? And I said, yeah, I'm in notes. And they said, oh, no, we use Excel. Okay. So, you know, so even in that way, you know, if we're just that delivery vehicle and we do it at such a great price, we made it affordable and accessible and easy to work with, and the customer service that we give and the experience that we give, it's up to people that are, you know, making, you know, Google Glass, remember those days, or, not Facebook, but Apple's come out with their version now and all that, and let those creators and those designers kind of harness.
Take it from there. Well, you know, that kind of comes out in the fact that, people don't really think about hardwire bandwidth anymore.
No.
And that's Wi-Fi and it's mobile.
Yeah. Right?
But they forget that you got to have that infrastructure or none of those other things are going to happen. And they forget about the cable that's connected, the fiber optic that links all that together.
Yeah.
Right? And it's just become like, I like to use the analogy with clients, like flat screen TVs. Mm-hmm. No one says flat screen anymore.
No.
You know?
No, they just
so they got TV.
Right. You know? Just TV.
Yeah.
Right. Or you've got the big one that you're just waiting for the big trash day
yeah.
to get rid of, or if you still have it, you yeah. know, congratulations. Yeah. Yeah, you probably could sell it on eBay for a few, yeah. few $100.
Exactly. But, so let's go back in time a little bit. Like we talked about before in the opening, that your innovative ideas, especially with you ran the OU store,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
And sold products to students as well as supplied the 8,000 employees, 8,000 plus employees. But you're always coming up with new approaches in that. And so tell me how your brain works from an innovation side and how you get that, how you get, and this is, I think, good for other leaders in your position to know, how do you sell that? If you're selling it to a board or, you know, whoever you're reporting to or even your customers, you know, how, what was your approach?
To me, it's you just got to be fearless, I think, right? Uh-huh. You know, I remember when we had the stores there at campus, and we brought in the first 3D printer.
Uh-huh.
And that was, 2011, 2012, if I recall correctly.
Mm-hmm.
We printed the first chess piece, right? Ran across the street, showed it to all these people, showed it to you probably, you know, our boss at the time, everybody else. And they said, well, do it again. I said, I don't know what we're doing. And I fast forward to today, and my daughter is a student at OU, and she said, you know what I think is so crazy about going to school at OU right now? I said, what's that? She said, every class I take, there's a 3D printer in my class.
Mm-hmm.
And I think about how we had to sell the dream,
to
sell that idea, right? And I think that's the point of whether it's a, you know, 3D printer at a university environment, or if it's, trying to explain to somebody that they, you know, that fiber to the X or fiber to whatever is the way to go.
Uh-huh.
It's really getting the buy-in and getting to understand how you have to read the room, and you got to know when to push and when to pull and when to, be so strong in your convictions that you can let it go.
Mm-hmm.
I think at the same time, right?
Yeah, sure.
And understand that what I've understood probably since I probably understood this when I was at OU, I just never could quantify it or put it into context, is that experience is the new commodity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can sell you anything, but if I can't give you that experience that you expect and deserve, then you're going to complain about that, right?
Yeah.
It's interesting. I was reading this, I was on Facebook, and there's this group of people that buy a certain brand of boot.
Mm-hmm.
And they were talking about, they went to the store and they said the experience was horrible. I didn't get a drink offered to me. They didn't offer to shine my shoes, but I could go to this other store that was more expensive, and they were so nice to me. And everybody was arguing about the price and why do you think you're so entitled and blah, blah, blah. And I just made a comment. I said, because experience is what he went in there for.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the experience is what you want to sell.
Uh-huh.
And because I can run fiber to your house just like any other competitor can.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that if I notice that your equipment in the home is offline and I'm calling you, I could call you right now and I'd say, hey, Dan, we've got a problem at your house. You're like, didn't even know my network was down.
Uh-huh.
That experience is what people want. And so trying to explain that to people is very difficult, because whenever first day at OEC, and my boss is just a brilliant man, and he's so much fun, and he's funny and entertaining. But I told him, I said, you know, it's going to be an experience. He said, no, it's not an experience. He's an engineer by trade, right?
And that's hard to convince an engineer.
Right. And so now he talks about it, because I think he understands that value. I know he understands that value of the experience that we deliver.
Uh-huh.
And so trying to get people to that moment of just, and then stepping back and saying, oh, you're right. It was your idea or whatever, you know, it's just that.
Yeah. I remember that, like the 3D printing or whatever the innovation was at the time, that fearless, I thought, was a good word, because you go to the president and say, hey, I'm going to show this to you. And he lived in his
own world, man. He was on his own world going on.
Not a technology guy.
Yeah.
And had bigger,
not at all.
Bigger, broader view. And then you'd show them.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd show them. You'd say, hey, come in, take a look at this.
Yeah.
And you'd actually bring them in to experience what it was you're talking about before even really.
Yeah.
Right?
Because my brain doesn't work in the fact that, you know, we've seen all the innovations with 3D printing, right? I think whenever somebody said, I 3D printed a home, I was like, okay, that is way out of what I thought. But it's the, But it was really what the driving force was saying, there's something here. Mm-hmm. My brain just doesn't work in that way as a creator, mm-hmm. like where I can sit down and look at it. Remember Jordan Wayne, who used to work for me. He works for me now mm-hmm. at OEC Fiber, and brilliant mind too, because he just sees it differently whenever mm-hmm. you put the tool in front of him. Mm-hmm. And I'll say, hey, you know, let's talk about this experience or that experience or whatever. And then he just takes it to that next level. And I think that's where we were, especially at that time at OU, was that everything we were doing, we had, you know, Google Glass to Oculus Rift to, you may remember when we were doing digital signage on the floor and you stepped on it and certain things happened. Yep. We were using Xbox. Whatever that.
And you had people from other universities coming in looking your layout of your
they tried to replicate it. Yeah, they always said they said, how did you do this?
Yeah.
And it's hard to replace, right? Because you were a key to that. Because when a professor stopped you or a staff member or somebody in IT and they said, what is David doing over there? And you're like, I don't know. But leave him alone because it's making IT a different I think what I did and what we did as a whole too was make people think of IT differently rather than turn it off, turn it on. Do you have a blinking light?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
KTLO, keep the lights on.
Exactly. And I think that was the challenge, right? Mm-hmm. Is that it was something that was innovative and different, and it was hard to understand.
Yeah,
we were talking 2012.
Yeah,
not too long ago.
Yeah,
but at the same time, that was quite a ways back. And so I remember we had probably at one time, I was trying to think about it on the way up here about this, we had probably close to 15 or 20 3D printers mm-hmm. that were running.
Yeah.
And you remember when we 3D printed the football stadium?
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I went to athletics and I said, can I have the plans of the football stadium? They said, no. But I looked at the students that worked for me, an architect, a nursing major, political science.
So you'd pull on whatever brain power you needed.
And so I bought them a camera. Uh-huh. And they went over and took pictures of the stadium.
And I think that's an important point, too.
And 3D printed it. Yeah.
I think that's an important point, too, is pulling on resources that you normally may not consider or pull on, or maybe that's not their space.
Right.
But, you know, identifying those people that can be.
Right. Because the nursing student was a nursing student, but his passion lied in other things that were fun.
Yeah.
They were just college kids, right? So they were always exploring.
Sure.
And so they always kept it fun, and, you know, just very entertaining and you know, challenging and things like that. And so, when you go print 400 OU football stadiums with no plans.
Yeah, that's right.
And he said to me, how many are we going to make? And I said, till we run out of electricity. And now I'm working for an electric utility. So joke's on me, right?
Yeah, so it comes around.
It comes around.
So how, past and even today especially, what's your way of keeping up, right, with the breakthroughs, either in your industry or in the past?
Yeah, that's just crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's because, you know,
I mean, how can you go a day or take a step? I mean, does AI come up in your industry at all, or is it?
I've used it to answer some emails. I'm like, because, I I'm 52 and I hit some mental roadblocks, right? But even trying to understand that and where does that go? Mm-hmm. It's kind of scary, mm-hmm. right?
Oh, yeah.
But keeping up is a hard part because we offer, you know, fiber to the home and fiber to the business. We offer a phone service. And then we also offer a TV service. Mm-hmm. And TV industry as a whole is just crazy. Mm. From traditional cable to streaming to, you know, they call them cord cutters. You know, we've known that forever.
Yeah.
And all that stuff. But man, talk about a crazy industry. And so they've always asked me, so what blogs do you get and everything? I had to turn them all off. I really did. I had to turn them off because I was getting caught up in so much of buy this, do this. I mean, there's a blog I used to get about cord cutting and they were just kind of contradicting themselves every mm-hmm. day with mm-hmm. articles. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, this is clickbait 101 right here, right?
Yeah.
And so really what I do personally is it's simple. I just talk to the team that works for me, mm-hmm. talk to the installers, talk to the people that are answering the phone, that are saying, did you turn it off? Did you turn it on? You know, that type stuff. Uh-huh. When we do an install, in a new home or a new business, I send them a thank you card and said, you got mm-hmm. any problems? Let me know. If you loved it, let me know.
Oh, okay.
And they reach out to me. So I find out if I installed it at your house and you call me and you're like, hey man, I can't seem to, get good solid connection in the back of my, mm-hmm. you know, house or whatever. Well, we went out and found a tool that we use.
So that leads to new ways, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so the way we do an install is way different than we were doing it back whenever we started in 2019.
Offering customer feedback and what your employees
feedback, and then we harness that the tools that other people have made. There's a company we use called Route This that that uses Google Maps and mm-hmm. uses the mapping of the home, places it in there. So whenever we do an install, we do it in an optimal place. We mm-hmm. use the technology to guide us around the house. Mm-hmm. So we'd walk your entire house, and if there's a poor signal strength, well, we'll put an extender there. Or we'll do some different things. We'll make sure we're not on the 2.4 or the 5 gigahertz network or whatever. Mm-hmm. But we're doing that now, but we weren't doing that in 2019.
Yeah.
And now we've got 36,000 customers almost.
Yeah.
And so the way we've evolved, because it's kind of like when you buy a car and they say, well, we're going to take you to the service department. You're like, why are you taking me there? I don't ever want to go see those guys and gals, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And my idea is that what we always had is that when you took our services, that I never wanted to hear from you again mm-hmm. because I wanted it to be like when you go home and you flip on the lights,
yeah.
it just works.
There. You don't even think about
it. You don't have to think about it. And I think that's what we've done is we've just taken the confusing, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because when we came to the market, it was very simple. 2-speed packages, 2 base prices. That was it. Yeah. No hidden fees. It was just, we made it so simple that it disrupted the market so much that I started seeing all the competitors starting to talk like us, act like us, feel like us and everything else. But what we, about a year and a half, 2 years ago, always trying to look ahead, as I said, we can play the speed and feed game and mm-hmm. we can race to zero and mm-hmm. we can do all that other stuff.
Yeah.
But what I felt at the time was that service and support, mm-hmm. that the fact that I send a note card and a gentleman had called me one day and he said, you sent me this card over a year ago and I got a problem. He said, I just found it. I've been looking for it. And I thought, holy cow.
Yeah.
And it just says, thank you for taking our service.
Yeah.
You got any problems, questions, complaints?
Yeah, that's great.
Let me know. So,
it's amazing the number of, a couple, not a lot, but some clients that have not talked to their leadership has not been in contact with their clients, their customers.
Yeah.
They leave that, they outsource that to people on their staff and they don't actually do it themselves. So that's a really interesting idea is going yourself to the customers, finding out, having that kind of engagement.
I've been in a lot of people's homes.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning that we did, we had so many people that just wanted our services so much because our electric footprint there in Norman, we span over 7 counties. So it's very dense and it's very suburban and it's very rural and it's all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we announced we were going to do fiber, everybody just kind of lit up. They didn't, they kind of knew what it was, but they kind of didn't.
Yeah.
They knew it was a new technology. They'd heard about Google Fiber. I mean, I remember when we were at OU, I remember when Google Fiber was announcing they were coming and everybody was excited. I remember that vividly that day.
Yep.
And it's been just an interesting way of approaching it in a different way
mm-hmm.
that I think, works for them. Because like I said earlier, is that, some people, right now what's changing is, 5 years ago we were getting people connected, right? That had 10.3 or something like that, right, mm-hmm. on their speeds. And now we got them, they can have 100-100 or they're getting a gig.
Yeah.
Symmetrical, no data caps, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's unheard of, right? So you disrupted the industry.
Uh-huh.
Well, now the competitors and others are saying, well, you got to go multi-gig. You got to have 3 gig. You got to have 5 gig in your house. And they equate that to speed,
uh-huh.
right? And so I'm sitting there, kind of like my Mel Gibson moment, right? As I'm sitting there and I'm hearing all this, I'm hearing it from marketing, the network team, they're arguing, constructions like tap values. We got to go back. I mean, you're just getting hit all over. And I said, wait a second, time out. I said, 2 years ago, Dan had nothing.
Yeah.
And now he's got 100-100.
Yeah.
So we're going to turn around as a trusted advisor on the electric side. And now we fully believe on the fiber side and say, well, that's not good enough, Dan. You need to have 3 or 5 gigs.
Mm-hmm.
And I've asked our partners and I've asked the team and I said, what will the home of the future look like mm-hmm. that is going to demand that much speed? Because mm-hmm. I can't do it today because I could do it, but it would cost a ton of money.
Yeah.
For what?
Yeah.
Because people would just buy it because.
Mm-hmm.
And then, because your phone's not going to get 5 gigs.
That's right.
You know, so they're going to do speed tests. They're going to, you'll come over to my house and be like,
and everyone can do speed tests now. They know how
to get, and nobody does them anymore because it just, especially with us, I've not heard anybody say, well, I did a speed test.
Yeah.
It's usually just like my network's down, you know, or I'm having a problem or something like that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And so nobody's going to come over to your house and you're going to have 5 gig and you're saying, let me show you something, you know, and you pull up your phone and you hit it. It's like, so what?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's that's what I'm struggling with is where does that home of the future going to be in 10, 15,
great.
20, 25 years?
Yeah. The name of our podcast is High Beam because that's what it's actually a service we provide, which is looking at your industry 10 years down the road.
Yeah.
You know, where it's going to be beyond 5 years.
Yeah.
Strategic plan. Yeah. Within 5 years. What's happening down the road? What do you got to be prepared for? What's going to be disruptive? And I thought you'd be there because that's kind of how you think.
Yeah. And I'm getting there, right? I've been thinking about it probably the last 6 months to a year. Because, you know, when we started in 2017, I'm coming up on 6 years now. So really took everything as 5-year chunks.
Yeah.
Because I think in this industry, especially trying to guess 10, 15, 20, 25 years, I mean, it's not a...
But you can still speculate.
You can still speculate,
I mean, you said home in 10 years, which I really like that. I mean, that's really good out of the box, really forward thinking.
Yeah.
Because it's going to be different.
And, way different.
Yeah. And you will, you know...
I mean, I remember
10
saying...
10 years is in your horizon too.
Right. Sure. I remember saying to one of my team members, I said, you know, are we going to have robots, you know, around the house? I mean, what will the demand be? I said, because I used to have a Roomba, but I had a dog. So connect the dots there, right? So I got rid of the Roomba after the third time of saying, that's it. And he's a you know, little 1 foot tall terrier. He's a basset hound, right? So he's, so I look at that and I'm like, okay, well, we've got that in our world. We've got all these other devices, but I'm, you know, looking across the table here at, you know, different headsets. And I'm like, okay, so what is that going to be like?
Yeah, like VR and AR and...
Right, because you and I can understand it. We think it's cool, but we're both wearing glasses and we're just like, yeah, we're in our glory years now, you know, whatever, blah, blah, blah. But my 20-year-old daughter, you know, earlier what I was talking about was whenever she said, you know, every class I'm in, and she's a... She's changed her major so many times, but she's in the College of Arts and Sciences. She's following her dad's footsteps, but she's adapting to this new world, and I don't even think it's going to be ready for her.
Yeah.
I think it's like my grandchildren.
Oh yeah,
that will be the benefiters of me just connecting these homes. So somebody in Verdon, Oklahoma, which is, you know, 45 minutes, what is that, west of Norman, that, you know, 300 people in the town, 300 homes, excuse me, has the opportunity to do something different that I probably won't live long enough to see it, but I've just got to figure out how do I keep delivering that exceptional experience, that uptime, the redundancy that we have, the failover, everything that we can keep the world connected, right?
That's great.
It's a challenge.
Yeah, that's great, David. That's a really good way to wrap this up. I do want to ask you a question, though. It's probably it's going to be a stupid question of the deal.
No.
So you still a Van Halen fan?
Oh, man. You know, everybody, you know, most people remember, if you're old enough, remember where Elvis was when he died, right? I remember where I was when Eddie Van Halen died, man. Yeah. You know, and here's the funny thing, because you know how my brain works. It's a little different, right? So for those who... Now, no, right, is that it's either David Lee Roth or no Van Halen at all, right? I remember Loretta Early, who I think dearly of, she used to always ask that question, remember? We'd be interviewing people, she'd say David Lee Roth or Sammy Hagar. And
if anybody wants to know anything about Van Halen, David's the man.
But when Eddie passed away, man, my musical taste changed.
Oh, really?
And I think that's what this industry is doing at the same time. You know, good way to kind of wrap it up, right?
Yeah.
Is that... Your tendency to want to gravitate towards it or not gravitate towards it is changing, you know? And I think that's we're that vehicle for that innovation, that vehicle for the future that, you know, hopefully my grandkids will, you know, do something that'll make it to where my mom right now is probably in a lift going to the doctor. She orders all her groceries. She pays all her bills online. Now, if you've stayed with the podcast this long, let's go back a few minutes. My mom's 82 years old.
Yeah, that's impressive.
And guess who's never ordered groceries to their house?
Yeah.
This guy.
Yeah.
And my mom does it every week.
Yeah.
And she's found a way to live in a new digital world, which is just mind-boggling to me.
Yeah.
I mean, she calls me and she's like, I need help with this and this. And I'm like, Mom, I don't know how to, I don't order anything from Target.
You'll be calling her and asking her. I don't order anything from them.
And yeah. so it's very, it's a challenge. And so I think that's the unique and fun part about all this.
Yeah, that's great.
Is trying to figure out how to keep delivering a great service like that.
Excellent. Well, thanks, David.
You got
Appreciate
it.
Appreciate it. It's good seeing
Thank
you again,
you.
Too.
Yeah, it's good seeing yeah. you.
We'll do this again.
You be on time next time.
Yeah. All right.
Thanks.
Hey, thanks, everybody. We'll see you on the next podcast.